again, everybody, and welcome to episode 35, a very special episode of Angles and Attitudes. As always, my partner John and I'm Mark. Today, we are joined by a very special guest from north of the border who spent numerous years covering the Montreal Canadiens for the Montreal Gazette. He's a hockey historian and author, and his free time now, you can see him on NHL Network. Please welcome Dave Stubbs to the podcast. Dave, thanks for joining us.
Good evening, Dave.
My pleasure, guys. Thanks for having me.
Big treat. So we went in there in our green room, and I held up this card and doing a little research on you. How about you tell us a little bit the significance of Rogie Vachon wearing that ugly purple and gold, I think you called it, versus the red, white, and blue of the Canadiens?
Well, Rogie Vachon was really my first boyhood hockey hero. I had followed the Montreal Canadiens early on. My full disclosure, 64. I am at the point where I look back and look at so much hockey, look at the history of the game. And for me, it's spending time with some of these legends that really, really turns my crank. I mean, that's the thing that's so exciting for me. In normal times, I'd go to the Bell Center, and some nights I never made it out of the alumni suite. And it's you just sit and you listen to the stories of some of these legends. And Rogie, I was, I guess, a wolf baying at the moon for decades about Rogie not being in the Hockey Hall of Fame because his numbers stacked up with his contemporaries in the game. And I really thought that he belonged there, no matter that he was my first boyhood hero. And I probably cried myself to sleep when he was traded to the LA Kings. But, you know, getting to meet Rogie as a journalist later on, we got to spend a bit of time on the phone, and then we met at a couple of signings and so on. And the long story short is I was delighted and literally flabbergasted to be able to pick up the phone and call Rogie and talk with him the morning that he was elected to the Hockey Hall of Fame in 2016. So we go way back. And then to kind of bring this around full circle, he came to Montreal just before his Hall of Fame weekend in Toronto, and he changed his flight so that he and I could fly from Montreal to Toronto together. And this is now, you know, 50 years after he would have had his first trip to Toronto going by train as a rookie with the Montreal Canadiens. So to do that was, I was black and blue by the time I got off that plane, pinching myself. But probably not as bruised as Rogie was. At one point, he pulled up his pant leg on the flight after he had told me that he had still a dent in his shin from a Bobby Hull slap shot. And he lifted his pant leg, and sure enough, his shin is still dented from a Bobby Hull slap shot. So Rogie and I go way back.
David, I have to tell you, it was what a career he had. He deserved to be in the Hall. And not that I want to talk about Rogie all night, but he sure took the words of Punch Emlak when he said, this is a junior B goalie. He was not a junior B.
Very different time, too. Punch Emlak and Toe Blake had absolutely wonderful feuds in the original six. Montreal-Toronto during its heyday was one of the absolute great rivalries in the game of hockey. And to the point that the Canadians took a road trip to Toronto, and I think that Toe Blake had forgotten to pack a pair of socks, so he sent the equipment manager or the trainer then up the street to a department store, and he came back with a pair of socks that unfortunately had a maple leaf on them, and Toe refused to wear them. He went barefoot in his shoes behind the bench because he was not going to be seen wearing a maple leaf on his socks, even if no one saw it. He just knew they would be there, and there was no way he was doing that.
Well, that's the beauty of looking back now, and I was looking yesterday, Guy Lafleur turned 70, and for John and I, you know, late 50s, early 60s, watching the hair flow and the Danny Gallivan calls and all those other things, as a kid, bright-eyed watching that, to think he's 70 years old now, and I saw some of the pictures on your Twitter account of you know, Cournoyer and Lemaire and, you know, Sir Savard, and it just goes on. And for you to be able to be a part of that, that's just, I got to figure you're still pinching yourself. You probably got to wear a shirt that goes with black and blue all the time, right?
Yeah, I truly do. The year 2017 for me. Well, I worked for 28 years at the Montreal Gazette when Gary Mahar, the senior vice president of communications for the NHL, turned up behind me in the press box at the Bell Center. So it would have been December of 2015 and just started to talk. And Gary and I knew each other. We went back quite a ways and we just were sort of having a nice session just back and forth. The second period, he's still standing behind me, still talking. And at one point I said, Gary, like, with all due respect, I have a game I've got to cover and I have a deadline column I have to get written here, but like, let's keep talking. So ultimately what Gary did is he told me that the NHL had a centennial coming in the year 2017. It would be the 100th year of the NHL. And he said, we would like you, we've been paying attention to the work you've been doing, and we would like you to come and do what you do for us at the NHL. So having been at the Gazette for 28 years and having been in the news business since 1976, I thought long and hard, because it's obviously it was a leap in faith. I mean, to leave the industry that I knew, but you know, the curiosity never leaves you. The way that you report, the way that you do interviews, the way that you treat your subjects with respect and with and treat them with the reverence that they deserve and really listen to them. None of that changed. So I was delighted to make the jump to the NHL. Through the year 2016, I started to build a bit of a head of steam. And then 2017 was literally shooting the proverbial fish in a barrel. I mean, every time I turned around, I was sitting down talking with the legends one after another, doing feature profiles and going to the All-Star game and then going to a variety of events, kicking off the year with a, I guess it was a Heritage Classic game that was played in Toronto, and then going out to Los Angeles. And there was the gala introducing the top 100 NHL players of all time profile. Filing about maybe 15 or 20 of them, including Gordie Howe, Jean Beliveau, Maurice Richard, Elmer Locke, one after another after another. So, you know, through the all of the year 2017 was, I was literally a kid in a candy store. It was an incredible run. And for every 10 stories that I heard, I could use maybe a half of one, because once these guys take you kind of into their confidence, there are no filters. They tell you all the stories that you fully well expect to hear and that you're shocked to hear, but it gives you some great context into who they are and why they played the game and why the game was so important to them and to their teammates when these guys were riding the rails together and when they were, you know, traveling and playing the game really for the love of the game, not for the money in those days. So yeah, it's been an absolute delight, and I'm still doing what I do. I still have great energy. The NHL still loves what I'm doing. They haven't caught on to me yet. So I'm just having a ball talking to these guys and writing their stories. I've written too many appreciations and too many obituaries in my life for these guys, but I've always believed that what I want to do is pay tribute to these gentlemen while they're still with us, celebrate their careers and their lives. And then when they are no longer with us, pay them the respect and the due that they deserve with additional stories and additional features. And hopefully maybe turn a kid on to going to Google and Googling a name and looking back into some of the legend of who some of these players are. And not just the legends, guys, of course, it's, you know, some of the journeymen, the guys on whose backs the NHL was built. So that's been the joy of doing what I do for sure.
Dave, I have to tell you, we interviewed a gentleman here in the States, which I'm sure you heard of, and I think maybe Mark's going to relate to this too, my partner, Chris Myers, and I look at some of the interviews you've done and he's done, and how could your job ever get boring? I think between the two of you, it's in the thousands of interviews of some of the greatest athletes ever, and like Mark, the way Mark opened this up, when I was looking at all and studying you now for the last 3 weeks, and of course watching you all these years, I said to myself tonight, where do we begin with the legendary Dave Stubbs? But this is fantastic.
Well, these guys have been just so good for so long. And one of my favorite stories was, and I've told this often, I was a big Montreal Canadiens fan growing up, I guess around just getting close to the expansion in 1967. I was going to be 10 years old. The Canadiens were playing the Maple Leafs. They were heavily favored to win the Stanley Cup. And it's a school night, game six. And my dad says at the end of the second period, you've got to go to bed, but don't worry, the Canadiens will win tonight. Force game seven. I'll let you stay up and watch the whole game. Well, I wake up the next morning on my 10th birthday, and my dad has a long face, and he says, I don't know how to tell you this, but the Maple Leafs won, and they've beaten the Canadiens, and they've won the Stanley Cup. I said to my father, apparently, I don't recall this, but he told me many times before he passed that I said that morning, I hope the Maple Leafs never win the Stanley Cup again. So karma, I don't know. I mean, here we are, how many years later, and the Leafs still haven't won the Cup, right? But yeah, so on New Year's Eve of December 2016 going into 2017, I'm sitting having dinner with Dave Keon in Toronto at the kickoff of all of this. And I walked up to him, I said, David, I've been sitting on this for about 50 years, but like, I've got to ask you, I mean, you guys beat my quote unquote Montreal Canadiens on the eve of my 10th birthday. And I woke up on my 10th birthday and it was destroyed for all intents and purposes. How do you feel to know that you just totally devastated a kid and trashed his birthday? And David looked at me very seriously, looked almost sympathetic for a second. Then he said, you know what? It feels really good. And so it was the perfect answer, right? And David and I have become really quite good. I mean, we spend a lot of time on the phone. We don't get to see each other as much as we like. He lives in Florida. But he, like me, is a bow tie aficionado. And we compare where we buy our bow ties. And we spend a lot of time talking about the game as it was. And I call him too often when someone has passed. And I need to get some insight, some reflection from David on that. But he's absolutely wonderful, as are all these guys, any of them. When I pick up the phone and call, they take the call. And if they're not there, they return a call without fail. And I'll tell you something, it's very special when you look at your phone and you see the name Guy Lafleur flashing, or Scotty Bowman, or any of these guys, Johnny Busick calls, or Alex Delvecchio, Gordy when Gordy was with us. So again, it's just such a wonderful tapestry of all of the guys I've been able to speak with over the years. And I look back at some of the stories that they told me, and it's an absolute honor to be able to tell their stories and spend any time in their company.
Well, that's in and of itself is a tribute to you, that those gentlemen, and I use the term a lot in terms of gentlemen, and it goes back to, you know, Jean Béliveau, and you just as a kid growing up in the States and not totally being immersed in it the way you would be up in Canada, but you just revel in that because and watching hometown hockey on Sunday nights and the joy that it brings. And the flat out just innocence. There's no preconceived we're better than you or whatever. Can you talk a little bit about what that is about? Just seems to be about hockey players that, like you said, you've grown, they're on your phone. You can pick up the phone and call. There's no pretense that they're too important or they're too big for the game. Kind of where that you'd see that comes from in those players or that generation.
Yeah, I don't know where it all comes from, but these guys did not play the game for the money. I mean, they came from, you know, the local pond. They played on outdoor ice. A lot of these guys, when they were playing early on, they weren't playing in arenas. And there was just this great love of the game. Gordy Howe famously got his first pair of skates when some woman was going door to door out in Saskatchewan and was didn't have any money to feed her own family. And she dumped a bag of miscellaneous goods on the Howe floor, and there was a pair of skates in there. And Gordy, I mean, had to stuff, you know, socks in them to fit his feet, and he went out and skated on the ponds until his toes were frozen. So there just was a real sense of what the game meant to them. There was a real love of it. Dickie Moore was a gentleman who I got to know really well. Dickie won the Stanley Cup a bunch of times, won the scoring championship in Montreal. An absolute prince of a man who has since left us. But Dickie would famously say, today's NHL players are making a ton more money than I ever made, but they're not having a fraction of the fun. Because when these guys would ride the trains, they were really a family. They would stay in the same hotels. They roomed together. There were no single rooms for these guys. They went to meals together. They hung out together in the summer. So there wasn't the United Nations of hockey that there is today, where guys at the final siren are jumping on planes and they're flying back to Europe and to wherever they would live. These guys had to hang out together. And, you know, the Montreal Canadiens, the French Canadian players, certainly, they stayed in the city during the summertime. And if they hadn't either won the Stanley Cup or gone very deep into the playoffs, they had to answer to that to every single fan on the street corner. And Guy Lafleur would say that, you know, like today when the Canadians make the playoffs, it's a big deal and it's a very different game. But Flower will tell me that the fans would tell him, if, you know, why didn't you win the Stanley Cup? And there was that was sort of the barometer. That was the level of excellence that you were expected to achieve. So for these guys, certainly in the so-called original six era, and certainly, I mean, I have some dear friends on the Chicago Blackhawks and the Bruins and the Red Wings, even the Maple Leafs, and that's sacrilege to say for a guy who's sitting here in Montreal and the Rangers. I mean, it's very, very special. I think they're all beautiful uniforms. I love going through the history of the game, and I love going through the old photographs that were taken where you see the depth of the snow on the carbon steel blades. And you see the goalies' faces before these poor souls wore masks. And you know, you just, it was a different time. So these guys were really, they really were a brotherhood. And maybe that same brotherhood exists today in a bit of a different way. But to talk to some of the legends of the game, as I have over the years, I mean, you really get a sense that it was family. And the bond of brothers that these guys had was something that was absolutely unshakable.
I think
one thing is for sure that you're saying, and I found that out, you know, setting up these interviews with myself and Mark, Dave, is that these athletes of that era, that original six, and I've talked to a lot of them lately, and they never forgot where they came from. And you hit the point exactly here. Never forgot where they came from. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely right. I mean, they really did. Yeah, they knew the roots and they never forgot that. And it was very special for them to go back home and to embrace their hometown. And these guys had to work jobs in the summertime. I mean, they couldn't make ends meet on what they made. I mean, they were they owned gas stations and they delivered beer and they were working on golf courses, on driving ranges, driving tractors, picking up golf balls. I mean, it was ridiculous that these guys all. But this is what they did. And they, Dickie Moore, you know, established this now. It's an international giant equipment rental company, and Dickie Moore trailers are all over Canada and into the United States. You know, he started this business in the back of a Dairy Queen ice cream shop that he established, that he built in the summertime because he needed to make ends meet. And now this thing became this huge giant company, and Dickie would just have fans come in off the street. They just walk in, they'd go up to reception, and is Mr. Moore in? And Dickie would have them back to the office and sign autographs and make them feel like they were the most important people in the world. So that's something that in some ways is lost today, and just what the world has become today maybe makes that a little necessary. But you know, I remember getting the autographs that I got on the back of my dad's checks. And you see kids today standing outside the garages of arenas with binders, with the PVC sleeves, with 20, 30, 40 hockey cards. I didn't collect hockey cards as a kid, you know, so I got autographs on scraps of paper. So, yeah, times have changed. I'm not hearkening back to the good old days, but that's what it was for me. And I love thinking about those days, and I love reminiscing about those days with the guys who played the game during that time.
Well, we've even seen it now with, you know, the resurgence of the Blackhawks, but John and I are unfortunately old enough to remember, like you are, standing outside at gate 3.5 in the parking lot at the Chicago Stadium, battling the elements to wait, to know who was coming out. And if it was Tony or Cliff Portal or Stan Mikita or those guys, and just to your point, you would stand and wait, and then you forgot you didn't have anything for them to sign. So you, like you said, whatever it was, hey, you got anything? Hey, you got any? No, that's mine. I can't use your pen or whatever. But those were, and I think those are some of the things, and both John and my son played, you know, at the amateur level, but to get them to understand those moments. And then the first time one of our kids goes, he's in a suite at the United Center. And it's like, no, that's not, you won't even watch the game from there. You need to be right in the second balcony. We were talking to Murray Bannerman the other day about, he laughed when we talked about walking up the stairs. It was hard because our feet would stick to the floor that had been covered in beer and baked and smoked. But that was our world. That was our world. And you got to know everybody next to you because people didn't sell their tickets to the Canadian games or the Edmonton games to pay for their season tickets. You went to every game. You played hurt more than the guys on the ice, right? I mean, you were not, you were afraid. Like, you were proof. Your dad didn't let you stay up, and look what happened. We were always, you know, our wives would be like, one of 80, can't you? No, we can't miss it, honey. We have to go. Tonight's Dino Cicerelli, and we got to boo him and Glenn Sonmore. And those are the things I think that we take away, that our children now, or like John, right, playing outside. Did any of our boys ever play a game outside competitively?
Yeah, it went 20 below zero, right?
No. I remember my favorite, and we swapped stories, and we wanted to hear yours, Dave, but we, John and I, grew up right around a golf course, and we would play in the pond. Well, when the sun went down, there was no lights to figure out how to get out of the golf course. So we would trudge through literally feet of snow, and we'd come home hours late for dinner, and our dads would look at us and go, you guys have been suffering enough. You're red-faced. Your toes are freezing off. I can't punish you. You were just playing the game that you love, and the punishment was having to walk an hour in the dark through, you know, through those situations. So the player today, the game is a different game. You know, your take from all of this analytics, where does that fit in a game like hockey?
I think analytics are a great tool. I think that there is a great big toolbox that coaches and general managers and scouts use. I don't think there's an analytic that has been invented that can measure the size of a man's heart or that can measure how he's going to respond in certain situations. So I know a lot of teams are hiring these mathematical geniuses to literally break down whatever has happened when the Jovian moons are in a certain phase behind the planet Jupiter. I mean, I don't, some of that is probably really useful. But when you speak with a guy like Scotty Bowman, and believe me, I will certainly, anything Scotty tells me, I'll take to the bank. He'll say that, yeah, things like this are important and they should be a tool that general managers and that coaches can use. Maybe how you deploy a player in a certain situation or how he responds in a certain situation. But at the end of the day, there has to be some sense of intuition and there has to be some sense of just what a general manager or a coach feels in their gut when they're going to the draft table and when they're ready to make a line change in a key time in the game. Is this guy, no matter what the numbers tell me, is he going to be the guy who I need to be on the ice at this time? So I think analytics certainly they're a huge part of the game. There are some people who are massive proponents of it who believe that this is going to be the way the game will be played. I believe, again, that I think it's that is an important part of what the game has introduced. But I think that it certainly has to be just part, one of the many tools that a coach and a general manager will use to establish how a player will be drafted, how a player will be coached, how a player will be used in a certain situation during the game.
Do you feel the game has been watered down by all this analytics, Dave? You've seen a lot of games, and you've seen a lot of generations of hockey. What's your take on it now? We know, I always hear, yes, the game is faster. Could Keon, could Sawchuk, could Dryden, could Bellow go and played in this era? Your take on this?
I've talked to some of the great legends in Montreal, and I've asked them about that too. And there was a great line that Yvan Cournoy had at some point. I asked him, I said, so Roadrunner, you know, how would you do in today's NHL? He says, you know, 12, 15 goals. And I said, like, 12 or 15 goals. Are you kidding me? Like, really? And he said, well, you have to understand, like, I'm 70 years old, you know? So guys, they have a lot of fun with this. Right. But I think in conversation with guys like Gretzky and Mario Lemieux, Bobby Orr in situations when we get him, I think that you would understand that. And Larry Robinson certainly has spoken to this to me a lot. Great players of their generation would find a way to play the game no matter what the era is. I mean, fans will say, what do you think about this guy versus that guy? And, you know, it's a mug's game trying to compare generations and eras. You can't, because, I mean, the game has changed, the equipment, everything about it, travel, nutrition, the skates that these guys wear, the condition that they're in, the fact that they play the game as long into the summertime as they do. They take maybe 10 days off and then they're back into the gym with personal trainers. You know, it's just a very different time, but certainly the best players would find a way to play. And I asked Larry Robinson, I said, look, I watched the way you used to hack guys and bang guys down in the goal crease and so on. How would you do in today's NHL when the stick comes up and taps a guy on the pants? You're going to the penalty box. And Larry said, well, I'd probably spend the better part of 81 and a half games in the penalty box. You know, but I mean, he said, I would learn. You would learn what you can do, and you would learn how you try to keep a forward outside, and you would try to not give him the space. And time and space is one of the great phrases that players use over and over again today. But the best guys in the game would find a way to play the game in any generation, in any era. If you gave them the same equipment, you gave them the same advantages of training and so on, these guys were not the greatest hockey players of their generation without a good reason. I mean, these guys were superstars because they were the very best of the players who are out there. So I think you would see the best players of yesterday certainly among the best players in the game today if the playing field was even.
To that point, I know I was listening to Don Cherry podcast, and they were today, as a matter of fact, talking about what's a successful, and I have to be careful how I phrase this, a successful season for the Maple Leafs, right? And again, you look at coaches and youth and systems or whatever, and then what is it that the amazingly talented Mitch Marner and Austin Matthews, and what is it that then gets these guys over that next level? Again, Canadians take them out in the first round this past year, and I can see the smile on your face for that one. But you know, what is it that
Dave Keon, remember what I told you, buddy, okay? Like karma.
That's like the goat with the Cubs. But, you know, do they analyze too much? Because then we used to hear comments when Jeremy Colleton came in first with the Blackhawks, and Duncan Keith was like, there's just at a point, you just got to let us play. You got to let us read and react and let our skill sets take over and not fill our heads, but let our skills take over, right?
What is it, as they say, your best players have to be your best players. And you know what, whether or not the collars get tight, whether or not it's an issue of another team just figuring that they have, that maybe a team starts playing, not instead of playing to win, they're playing not to lose. It's a very fine line. And, you know, once you get into the playoffs, I mean, anything can happen. Nobody figured the Montreal Canadiens were going to go to the Stanley Cup final this summer. I mean, that was just no one considered that. I mean, a whole lot of things happened for the Canadiens to get there. And fans, I mean, now are thinking that this is the bar that the Montreal Canadiens has set. Well, it will be a very different situation this year, because when you play an 82-game schedule and you're going back to the divisions that you were playing in, a whole lot of different things have to happen. So, I mean, you wonder how all of this kind of works out in the wash. It's a great game. The beauty of hockey is that it is so totally unpredictable, that any team can beat any team on any given night, and some team that doesn't have a prayer against another team knocks them off, beats them that night. And we kind of just, you know, the old cliche is they were the better team on paper, but you don't play the game of hockey on paper. So, you know, if the Canadians found a way to bottle up guys like Austin Matthews and Mitch Marner, and if they found a way to win that seventh game and then get a bit of a head of steam, then, hey, good for them. It doesn't mean that the same thing is going to happen next year. It was a wonderful story. I did an interview a number of years ago with a gentleman named Commander Chris Hadfield, a very famous Canadian astronaut. He's now retired. Huge, huge Maple Leafs fan. He had a Maple Leafs jersey on the International Space Station and so on. Well, the Leafs were playing the Bruins in that famous game where they were up by, what, 3 goals, was it, in the third period? And they went down in flames. Well, as Commander Hadfield was getting into his capsule to return from the space station, he returned, came back through the Earth's atmosphere and landed on the steps in Kazakhstan. And the first person he called on the satellite phone was his wife. And she said, I don't know how to tell you this, dear, but your Maple Leafs are out. And he said, well, when I left the space station, they were winning. So we kind of joked with Chris, and I said, if the Maple Leafs lose while you're reentering the Earth's atmosphere and you're in radio blackout, does it count? I mean, the Leafs, they're one of the great running gags, unfortunately, I guess, for fans in Leaf Nation up here, because you see Maple Leaf fans walking out with signs over their head saying, I'm ready to have my heart broken again. At some point, I mean, you think that the talent that this team has and the way the league works, these guys are going to go deep. And if the Maple Leafs win, and if they ever win the Stanley Cup again, it will be unlike the city of Toronto has ever seen, because the great running joke is that, I mean, you can't find any color photos of the last Maple Leaf Stanley Cup parade. Well, they do exist. Believe me, I found them. And one of the other gags is the last time the Maple Leafs won the Stanley Cup, Lester Pearson was a prime minister in Canada, not an airport. So, you know, I have lots of friends who live in Leaf Nation and who live and die with the Maple Leafs, but, you know, teams, they have their ebb and their flow. And the Leafs knocked off my quote-unquote mighty Montreal Canadiens in 1967. And, hey, these guys hadn't met since 1979. So you figure these are two of the original six teams and they hadn't met in that length of time. That's what makes this a beautiful game. It's so much fun when teams can do things that are unexpected. And guys who aren't necessarily the stars of a team are going to, you're going to get secondary scoring and you get a goalie who is going to stand on his head and suddenly a defenseman is going to play like he's Bobby Orr and Doug Harvey rolled into one. So that's the beauty of this game for sure.
Is there a favorite, I'm going to put a little pressure on you. Is there a favorite Stanley Cup, Dave, of all the cups you want? Because, you know, Mark and I had to wait till 2010, even though we were both, I was around in 61, but I was 1 year old. But is that one Stanley Cup that stands out of all those Canadian Stanley Cups when you were on the Gazette? This was the one was like, wow.
Well, they shouldn't have won in 1993. I mean, Patrick Roy in 86 stood on his head as a rookie and pretty much was the reason why the Canadians won that cup. Well, in 1993, the Canadians won 10 overtime games consecutively. I mean, like, that doesn't happen. That was the famous Patrick Roy wink to Sandstrom, right, in Los Angeles. I mean, it was the – all of these different things were happening. So that was the one that's the most recent one. And you know, Jean Béliveau in his autobiography famously spoke of the Canadians having won the Stanley Cup from 56 to 60, then not winning again till 65, and writing in his book, "The Montreal Canadiens' Drought is Over." And you figure that, what, 4 or 5 years is a drought? I mean, there is now an entire generation of Montreal Canadiens hockey fans to whom the Stanley Cup is a rumor. They have no idea. Unless the cup comes through Montreal or they see it somewhere else. And it's engraved in Montreal. That's one of the great ironies. I mean, every summertime, the Stanley Cup comes back to a studio in old Montreal and it's stripped down, taken apart, and the names are tapped into the bottom band of the Stanley Cup, and off it goes. So, there are Canadians fans now who are thinking that they got as close as they have been since 1993 this past year. So that would be the one that kind of stands out, I guess, for me, because it's the most recent. But with all of the research that I've done in the history, the Canadians winning the Stanley Cup five consecutive years from 56 to 60, there were 12 players on all five of those teams, the same coach and the same general manager. Well, I mean, with the salary cap and with just the way the game works today, I mean, that would never happen. You could never keep that kind of a team together. And the Canadians were, if they weren't going to the Stanley Cup final, granted it was a 16 league, if they weren't going to the final, I mean, something was very, very wrong. And even in the 1970s, when they won their four consecutive cups from 76 to 79, the mayor of Montreal, and he wasn't being flippant, he wasn't being cocky, he wasn't being a wise guy, he put out a press release saying the Canadian Stanley Cup parade will follow the usual route. And that's what we knew in Montreal. I mean, you just knew in the springtime, you knew which day you were going to be cutting class or very close to it. You knew which street corner you were going to go. You knew you were going to hang outside the Montreal Forum and see these guys getting in convertibles rolling down St. Catherine Street. And that hasn't happened in a lot of years now in Montreal. So, but that run certainly of 56 to 60, and then the four in a row, the NHL in a centennial year, we did a fan vote of the greatest 10 teams of all time. And the Canadians team of 76-77, which went 68-12. I mean, they lost 8 games the entire season, finished third in the balloting. Well, when this was released, I think an Oilers team was first and maybe a Penguins team was second. When the balloting was released, 6:30 in the morning, my phone rings. I look down, I see Scotty Bowman, and I answer the phone. And before I've even said hello, Scotty says, "Well, I guess we should have lost none." And then he hangs up. He was really upset. He called back and apologized. And he sort of said, "Look, I mean, I'm sorry, but like," and I said, "Scotty, look, I mean, fan votes are what they are, right? I mean, they're beauty contests. And there's at one point, I think 4 Pittsburgh Penguins teams are running 1, 2, 3, 4 in that ballot. So I think Scotty's gotten over it, but he was seriously worked up that morning, I'll tell you."
Well, we have to tell our children to this day too that this is not the normal course of events with 10, 13, and 15. As John and I obviously suffering and normal circumstances, John gets to ask the last question because you've been just absolutely wonderful with your time, Dave, and we could go on and on. But I'm going to ask on John's behalf because his boyhood hero, obviously, we lost him just recently, number 35. So I'm going to ask you to share a couple of Tony Esposito stories to take us out, if that's okay, John.
Yeah, that'd be great. Thank you, Mark, for doing that. Dave, of course, I knew you knew Mr. Esposito well. As Mark said, he was my boyhood idol. I'll never forget 1969-70. And, of course, I'll never forget when the Canadians, I think it was Tommy Ivan was the general manager, picked him up for the $30,000 waiver price. At the time, we had a goaltender here in Chicago named Dennis DeJordy, and our goaltending was suffering when we had guys like Dave Dryden, Dennis DeJordy, and Jack Norris. And when Tony Esposito came, I think his first win was against Montreal in the Forum. It was a 5-0 shutout. And of course, that was the year of the 15 shutouts, and the rest is history. As a goaltender here in Chicago, of course, in 71, Mark and I still have nightmares of Andre Richard scoring that goal to win 3-2 when the Blackhawks took a 2-0 lead in the old Chicago Stadium. And we thought the night of May 18th, 1971 was going to be a euphoric night. But of course, Andre dashed all our hopes. Just before I close it off with you, Dave Stubbs, what kind of a guy was Tony Esposito?
Tony was one of the kindest, sweetest guys you can ever imagine. I was at the Hockey Hall of Fame a couple years ago and came upon a display of pucks. And I'm not sure if you're going to be able to see that one, but it's Esposito 35. And I picked it up and said, I've never seen this before. So I called Tony and he answers the phone and there's just some guy standing beside me. He said, Tony, I'm standing beside a display of hockey pucks. So the guy's eyes bugged out of his head. He suddenly understands I'm talking to Tony Esposito. He said, Tony, have you got one of these pucks? He says, no, I'll buy me one. And I'll pay you back for it. And I said, no, that's fine, Tony. Trust me, it'll be my pleasure, my privilege to buy you this puck. And so I did, and I sent it down to him. And there was a promotion maybe a year or so later at the United Center, and they were giving out metal Chicago Blackhawks lunch pails. And lo and behold, in the mail arrives this lunch pail from Tony saying, this is for the puck. So I was down at his home maybe 18 months or so before he passed. And it was, you know, even the way Tony passed was so typical of the type of man he was. I mean, when he was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, he told his brother and he said, you're to tell no one about this, because the last thing Tony wanted was for this to become a circus for his wife, Marilyn, and their two boys. So when Tony passed, I knew nothing about his illness. And I saw an email that just jumped into our email server from Commissioner Gary Bettman, and it said the NHL expresses its deepest regrets about the passing of Tony Esposito. And it literally knocked me down. It felt like I'd had the wind just sucked out of my lungs. And the more I thought about Tony and the stories, there was one that when I visited Tony and his wife at their home in Florida, we were looking out over Tampa Bay, and he had this beautiful old jukebox, about a 1959 stereophonic Seberg jukebox. And the sky was getting very dark over the bay. And I said, Tony, you've got about 60 or so, 45 RPMs in there. Have you got a favorite song? He said, I've got one you're going to listen to tonight. And he hit the button and he heard the machine word to life. And the 45 dropped down, and it was Frank Sinatra singing Summer Wind. I can't listen to that song again the same way. You know, Tony was very special. He was a wonderful, wonderful man, and miss him dearly. My best friend in hockey today is Glenn Hall. Mr. Goalie lives wonderfully out on his farm in Stony Plain. Yeah, there you go. Well, I'll show you this. That's a pine cone that my first visit out to Glenn's farm, I picked this up. And I said, I need a souvenir. And I took it away. And about 3 years later, finally, I had this terrible pang of guilty conscience. And I phoned Glenn, and he's, again, it's about 155 acre farm. He's got probably 30 or 40 massive towering pine trees. And I sent him, showed him this picture of this pine cone. I said, Glenn, I have to come clean. I took a pine cone as a souvenir, and he just looked at me and sort of raised an eyebrow, and he said, "So that's where it went." So if missed, that's Mr. Goalie, right? So I mean, to be as tight as I am with Glenn, and to has been to have been as close as I was to Tony, I cherish every moment I have with Glenn, who turns 90 on the 3rd of October. And and Tony, we've lost an absolute champion. I've lost a very dear friend, and I can't imagine how tough it is in Chicago for fans who have lost literally a cornerstone of those teams, a very popular man, a great ambassador. And I'm sure the Blackhawks will do something very, very special on opening night to honor number 35 for sure.
Well, thank you for sharing that.
And Mark, I just want to say one more thing to close it off here. Dave, I normally say that I really want to thank you for coming on this, but you're going to have to come back again, because this is a world wealth of information. This is not only an honor tonight for Mark and myself with our show. You are a legend, my friend, and I need to hear more. This is a night, truly, truly, that I am never forget. I mean, I'm just touched. Like Mark said, we were just thrilled. It's more than thrilled. I don't think there's a word in the vocabulary to say thank you tonight, Dave Stubbs, for this. This is tremendous.
Well, the honor's been mine, guys. Thank you very much for having me. Flattered that you'd ask, and you know where to find me. Call me anytime. It's been a delight to share some stories and reminisce about the game as it was, the games it is today, and certainly about some of the guys who have touched our lives. Some of these great hockey players who mean the world to us.
We're going to give you one more thing on the way out. The Angles and Attitudes is a tribute to Sinatra. The angle in which you wear your hat, the way you wear your chapeau, your fedora, it's indicating of your attitude. So it seems very appropriate with the Sinatra song from Mr. Esposito that you just shared, that the whole thing came full circle with that. So as John said, thank you very much. Stay well. And we'll look forward to watching you on NHL Network. The season's right around the corner. So thanks, Dave.
Guys, thanks again for having me. Really a pleasure. Thanks.
Stay well.